experience of working with writers makes us very clearly discover how much we writers, and especially writers with not enough experience, beginner writers or writers, emerging writers, let's say, tend to think that because it is called writing, the development phase of a script, because it is called writing, they tend to write much too early, meaning they put their fingers on the keyboard and they start to write, which is then creating something which is trapping them into a rigid path. Whereas what you just said is that we need to open the field of possibilities. And to open that, apart from using words as if it was just mind mapping, for instance, but using words as already writing something that looks like a treatment or a synopsis, means we as a writer, we trap ourselves when we write too early like this. So it's about, we often say that we should, instead of calling it writing, we should call it conceiving. Because it's very confusing. The fact that it's called writing, we put fingers on the keyboard. And we should postpone that for much. This is just being your own secretary, putting your fingers on the, there's a, one of our consultants that developed that idea, you know, the actual fingers on the keyboard means you become your, the secretary of the world you have created, of the path you created. But first you create the world, first you conceive. And then when things start to generate a proper shape, you can start to write to test possibilities, right? So do you have that, would you have that same feeling that for a screenwriter, writing too early, a treatment is trapping the creative process?
I would quote someone who is considered as genius and creative, like Einstein, who said that the formulation of the problem is often more essential than its solution, which may be just, you know, merely simple mathematical experimental skills. So to raise new question, new possibilities, to regard old question from a new angle requires creative imagination. So this is not from me. And it marks a real advance in science. So imagining, taking the time to imagine, to look at the problem from different angles, from different perspectives, and collecting information, reading, watching movies, going to galleries, looking at photos,
talking,
exploring, all these are very important in the process of creativity. And for scriptwriter, from what we have seen with the professional scriptwriter, if we summarize the time spent in the three phases of writing, we call it imprimation. This is the word that has been used frequently by scriptwriter to get
immersed,
but the right word used, it's to be impregnated by the story. So they spend a lot of time getting used to the characters, the story, the co-writer or producer or director or whatever. So the impregnation phase is very important. You can see during this impregnation, we have seen for some scriptwriters, they start, you know, writing some scenes or some dialogues. But it's not, you know, it could be the middle of something, it will be, you know, placed in the middle of the script, but it's just, you know, this is a good idea, so let's just write it and put it aside. Maybe they will keep it, maybe not. But the first step, and if we have to represent, you know, in sort of bubbles, this is the big bubble. It's the imprimation phase. Then there is the second stage, which is the structuration. You start structuring this huge amount of information you have collected, this thinking. And this is something that for some script writers, they start sketching things, you know, by diagrams or some structures. It could be something very formal, like an outline with, you know, all the rules and or treatments, but it could be something very simple that is a sort of a guide. It's sort of like a mental representation of the story, something that is not very clear, but it's here. This is my starting point. But then I will update my diagram or my structure when I start. And then there is this, Einstein called, it's just a simple matter of mathematical or experimental skills. So the writing itself starts after this big part of imperniation and the structuration. So when you start writing, it's another story. The idea you have during this phase, which is rich with ideas during the writing and rewriting, it's the richest phase of script writing. It's you cannot have all these ideas if you haven't spent time looking at the problem from different perspective, documenting the problem. It's exactly what Einstein called. He compared scientists with detectives. And he said, both of us, both scientists and detectives, have a problem to solve. But for the detective, the problem is given. You know, there is a murder. And we need to find who killed. But for the scientist, he needs to commit his own crime. So for the script writers, you need to start by this, what is the problem really? And this takes time. And once you have find the right angle, it could be like you, and if you are experienced, it'd be on automatic mode. So
yeah,
you will be.
You mentioned that yesterday by saying that if there's a theory, we need a problem, yeah. Does it happen, since I have no idea how people make script, I've never done this, I've never been working on that kind of thing. Does it happen that some screenwriters just write indications or just give drawings or just give to, and the movie comes from few indication, few drawings, so it's an openness, or it's a door open to a...
In very few cases it happens, but if you do that, you are in trouble to get money to first get, you know, your writing phase financed, and even more to get the production financed, you know. Very few people, there might be like 5 to 10 filmmakers in the world that can say,
do that.
This is my drawing, give me the money, I shoot, you know. So the rule in the business is that you deliver a script, and from that script, you will get the money. A script is a roadmap for the research that the shooting is supposed to be. But then that roadmap also gives parameters for a whole team, you know, set designers, DOP, etc., to prepare the job.
You have a little freedom in...
You have a lot of freedom, in fact.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think that there is never a final version of script. It's always challenged by someone, because it seems that is an individual work, but actually it's a collective work. Anyone who reads the script have an opinion.
Experienced screenwriters know that when they send a treatment to get the development money, to have the means to spend time on the script conception and elaboration, they know that the treatment they give is just a tool to get the means to develop. But for less experienced people, when they get the money with that treatment, it means that, wow, you know, this becomes like as if it was the most precious thing. It is just a small attempt, if you take into account the huge amount of work that still has to be done to develop the story. But then it becomes a tool that slows down the development because you have written something. So it is very important to then be able to say, okay, this stays there in a drawer, and let's go back to the fundamental work, which is conception. And here, I think it's, you were asking a question which I think is really interesting. What are the type of disciplines or the type of tools that can help the development of these different shapes that the story can take? And you were asking the question, can mathematical thinking help the conception?
I was intrigued by the fact that a lot of scriptwriters have a background in mathematics, and they are very creative. And I was thinking, maybe the practice of mathematics and abstractionness in mathematics can lead to abstract thinking, which is very important to imagination. So this is something that really intrigued me. And the other thing is about mental models. So when you are stuck in the production phase, in the writing and rewriting with and you are blocked, you need to change the mental representation of the script or of the scene, of the situation, to get unstuck. To have this insight. So mental models are representations of situations. So sometimes this representation of the situation has to be changed. And I was just wondering if this the practice of mathematics can lead to a figural mental representation. So it's just hypothesis and explain why we have some mathematicians or they have this kind of visual imagination or in script writing.
Well, as I said yesterday, diagrams are used in mathematics and physics because they, in some ways, they are nonverbal thinking. They're a way to develop nonverbal thinking. And many mathematicians and physicists will tell that words, phrases, sentences, usual grammar is an obstruction to the understanding of new theories or new calculation. So they need to develop different kind of tools. Roger Penrose exactly says, he says that words are an obstruction to understand new mathematical or physical concept. The idea, at least of diagrams, and this is related to our talk, are used in mathematics and physics as pre-formalization. I mean, they're used as tools to construct the intuition of a new theory. And by intuition, I mean a shortcut in a theory, to understand in a global way without all the details of theory. That's something quite interesting because if you look, for example, at Deleuze's book on Bacon, Bacon explains that before doing a painting, he has in some way tries to do something on the canvas which will not be the painting, but which will be some kind of formalization of what the painting will be, of what the painting could be. And it's exactly this the way diagrams are used in physics and mathematics. They're also used, as I said, also shortcuts in established theories. They enable the practitioner to do in a quick way long and complicated calculus. This is a very, very famous story. Quantum electrodynamics that was founded in the 60s was founded by Tomonaga, Schwinger, and Feynman. And Tomonaga and Schwinger made very, very complicated calculus. And Feynman came and just showed drawings. And it's amazing, instead of doing very long and complicated calculus, he just do drawing. And everyone doing quantum field theory now is practicing with Feynman diagrams. Though they also have that kind of role. And the third role maybe of diagrams, which is also related to our talk, is that they also have the power of suggesting. They are operators of suggestion, machines that in some way can produce potentiality, virtuality in an existing theory. And we were talking about just before the fact that you don't produce mathematics from nothing. You produce mathematics or new physics on the already existing ground. So there is a plasticity of diagrams in a way that at the same time they have the potential to to give shortcuts in a theory, and at the meantime be some kind of opening machines for new formalism or new procedure or new experiments.
Because one of the questions that we are asking ourselves is, we've seen that we have here an example of how Gus Van Sant uses diagrams to represent a possible options of narration in potential future films. And so the question is it possible to develop tools that can help us not only see better our own creation and understand deeper the nature of the complex architecture that we are building? Because a feature film, for instance, or a TV series is a very complex architecture made of paths and emotions and traumas and for a group of human beings. And the question is it possible through that kind of tool, which is, I think it's good that you give us your understanding of how a diagram works, or few possibilities maybe. Is it possible to enhance our ability to build, visualize, rebuild, reshape a story architecture through diagrams?
I would say yes, of course, I would say yes. And I would say yes because I believe one of the key features of diagrams is time and dynamics. And we've been talking already about this. From what I understand, a good script is a dynamic one. It's not a static one. So the idea would be to somehow try to be able to put dynamics, but not dynamics as a time linear representation of things, but dynamics in a way that things are not static in their representation, which is quite difficult because in some way a diagram is a static figure. But in somehow, at least in physics and mathematics, people are able to produce different kind of dynamics, not only one kind of dynamics, in a static figure. So I would say that, I don't know, but from a very exterior point of view, a good look on the script writing would be questions about its potential dynamics.
We often feel and experience the fact that when we try to draw the dynamics on a paperboard like this, the simple fact of trying to find a graphic representation of the dynamics happening in that story creates for the writer the possibility of a complete change of perspective within which new possibilities will arise, which would have been completely impossible to see and to guess within just the classic representation of a treatment, which is just a succession of phrases.
I understand perfectly. I would have a very practical advice. Switch to a blackboard with chalk, not only for ecological reason, but also because, every mathematician will tell you that they hate working on something else than blackboard, because you can erase. I cannot erase that. So when you can erase, you have more. That's a very practical. That's why I said practical one. You have even more the possibility to give potentiality to the drawing.
Replace change.
Yeah, and replace change. And instead of going to another page to, and you see that when you go to conferences, when you go on lectures, you see how the blackboard is really a tool for producing and understanding mathematics, much more than this kind of board.
With a Velleda, you can add the use of colors.
Oh, and blackboards too.
Blackboards too,
of course.
I understand from script writing in the phase of production, and this is not something apparently new, it's from the beginning of writing, is this cause effects, which is fundamental in the writing. If you forgot to think about the cause effect, yes. And this idea is exactly a mathematical one. And the thing is, maybe we should think about a way to present these links of cause effects, because it will give you the structure, and you can see the links that are missing between, because it's how a scriptwriter describe it, it's like domino effects. When you are in the middle of the script, you have written stuff before, but you imagined new action you didn't thought about it at the beginning. So this new action will have a domino effect on what happened before. And it will have also an effect on what is coming later. So these dynamics, as you said, in aviation there is a theory or a concept that we call situational awareness. So it's to be aware of the past, the present, and the future. Where I am now, what I have written before, and the future. So for a pilot, for example, there are, even in the design of the aircraft, there are 40 rules that help designers of cockpits to design tasks that will help the pilot to keep awareness or conscious awareness of what happened before, now, and the future, which is, you know, the descent and the landing and stuff. So when I read or analyze what scriptwriters are saying when they get blocked or stuck, they lose the sight of the whole. They forgot about, you know, the structure, because you have so many characters, so many actions, so many, and having a way to a diagram, but dynamic one, which means that, you know, when you can erase, when you can, you know, shift. So it's very important. So how can we develop something that can help these domino effects and this cause effect, which is a mathematical, and this word mathematical have been used several times for these professional scriptwriters, and saying it's something to do with mathematics. If you lose the sight of cause effects, you may end up with something that is not, you know, you are feeling uncomfortable with something.
It's a chessboard. The other analogy could be a chessboard.
Chessboard, I don't know. Cause effect is for me like algorithms. So is there something that can be imagined that would help someone? Because this awareness is very important.
For me, the problem again is that here you see that the major tools, the central tools that we're using all the time, logline, synopsis, treatment, outline, and the global draft, you know, with the dialogues, it's always written material. Whereas, as opposed to a novel, the final object that we will generate is just images and sound. So it has nothing to do with a novel. And the type of elaboration tool that we classically have and that is financed is just an addition of words and sentences, which in itself is not the most flexible tool. I think a logline is a very, and we, it's always, as screenwriters, when we have to produce a logline, it's always a moment of, you know, pain.
Yeah.
Because we feel it is not summarizing what the core of what we are working on is, you know? So it's that's very interesting, you know? And a screenwriter who had to develop 120 pages of script is in a very difficult, because so much the head into these hundreds of words that it becomes very difficult to have an idea of the global shape. Which means that here, developing more, you know, graphic tools of some kind would be tremendously helpful.
I think in the practice, a lot of screenwriters use arrows and on notebooks and do drawings, but the thing is they don't share their tools. It's like cooking tools, private cooking, their little tools, you know, for themselves. But it seems that, for example, I remember someone very well known, but it's an old generation, but Claude Sauté, he was an assistant director first before becoming a screenwriter and director. And he was drawing, if you see the documentary about him, you see that he's drawing on a wall and the wall is covered with drawings everywhere. But the film that he's doing is very verbal. But the conception is very, very
graphic.
graphic. So it's interesting, these differences, because drawing builds a way to build an analogy to see what you're doing in a more intuitive way and natural way, and also playful way, because we talked about playfulness yesterday. Yeah. So it's like a child drawing possibilities.
So just one thing about this. Bob Kerr, which is a great guy in quantum mechanics, wrote a book which is called Quantum Mechanics for Kindergarten. But it's very, very elaborate quantum mechanics, but it's just on diagrams. So it's really this idea.
I think there is two different kind of things. There is drawing to represent the structure from above, like you were in a helicopter and you're looking at a town with the lights, you know, only the lights. And then if you are into the town, not from above, if you are into it and you try to build a path, you need a drawing about the possibilities that you have. Or I can go this way and I can go this way, like a tree of possibilities, like a mind mapping work. But I think the two things are different. Sometimes you want to be in an analytical phase.
Absolutely.
You want to be from above to see, I'm on a plane, I'm above my story, what is it? But sometimes you want to be in the town and you want to travel into it and see, you want a map and not, you want a map to
absolutely.
To see.
That's right, that's so right.
Yeah.
In fact, the brainstorming is the map of the city. The drawings is when you are up and you see your job. That's exactly, and you have a kind of interaction between a vision and the structure.
I'd like to try something, which is show the classical graphic representation that we use very commonly for screenwriting, and to see whether a mathematician or somebody used to graphic representation in physics and mathematics, where from that, what would be the other, you know, tracks. I don't know, let's try, maybe it will lead nowhere, but the classical representation used by American theoricians, you know, American script gurus, it's most of the time that kind of representation, which is kind of used, which could be coming from the, from medicine.
Or for physics, it comes from physics.
Yeah, of course, but so here it's
it comes from it's
okay, and here it's, let's call it dramatic intensity, right? Which you can measure, for instance, in heartbeats, you know, for the intensity of the heartbeats for the main character, for instance, or for the viewer, you can choose. And it generates drawings of that kind. You know, you start with, during the credits, you have very little tension, so it's, and then there's a hook, and then there's classically the inciting incident, which is then generating a succession of, you know, climbing moments. And classically, Americans would divide this into acts, you know, first act, second act, three acts, and then this being first part of second act, and second part of second act, with here what they call, we can call the midpoint, right? So this is the very pragmatic, you know, pragmatic vision. You count the heartbeats for the viewer or for the character, and let's build the whole thing on heartbeats, right?
Can I say something about that? I don't think this is a diagram. This is a graphical representation, and in some way, it's a boring representation of what time is.
I was talking about
Bergson few minutes ago. I mean, one of Bergson's criticism, especially of classical physics, is the fact that when you do that, you represent time by space, and time is not space. So you miss the principal quality of time by representing as a linear line, which is not.
Yeah.
So this is not diagrammatic, it's just a graphic representation.
Yeah. And
you miss the dynamics of the thing by doing that.
Yeah, I agree. And here we are,
you
in
fake
a way,
dynamics.
We are also kind of stuck in also the most basic Newtonian vision.
Absolutely.
You know, it's okay. And what is interesting is we've been trying to go more into the use of vectors, right? To try to see things more in terms of dynamics, to translate dynamics. So it's like you have your, let's say this is the character, and what moves the character forward here, what creates movement. So you can create the fact that this is movement, or you can create the fact that this is, you know, meaning. So what happens outside and what happens inside. So that's a possible representation which is closer to what happens inside, let's say, if we talk about a character, is what moves physically, emotionally a character, you can choose the angles, and what moves the character from within more subconsciously. So that's a possibility. But then it helps us maybe conceptualize and help to see different angles, because this, you can use that for momentum, you can use that for different vectorial representation for motivation, but in the meantime you also can work on something that would be more you were talking yesterday about statistics and probability. You know, it would be as if a story was, you go from one coast, there's our friend Razvan Radulescu, who will recognize himself here, who was thinking in terms of you're crossing the ocean. Well, the story writing, it's putting yourself in the shoes of the writer. Here it's in the shoes of the character, right? Here it would be more in the shoes of the blind writer trying to see where it goes. Am I going to be landing in at the end? This is the ocean. The lost writer. and here you start, you know where you start from. And you know that your path is, okay, I want to go there. Where do I land? I don't know. But then you go, you know, you try, you believe you want to go to New York or to, let's say, to Mumbai. But you end up maybe in the Filipino, you don't exactly know how you sail because you have no compass. While you there's no GPS for the screenwriter in a way. So it's then the path, the writing path, you know, can be something that you can enter into a graphic representation. Then the question of Razvan was, can you use maybe statistics as a tool to modelize that path, where you can land after each of these segments could be 1 week of work, you know, and then you can see things also in terms of a tree of possibilities, which is you start with my character. There's maybe three possibilities to start that story if I believe that this is the starting point, and here. It's all the branches of the possibilities that you start, you know, and then it creates an infinite tree of possibilities within which you will have to make a choice. And maybe towards the end, you're choosing that among all of these, the one that suits the best my desire to explore a subject or a sensation or trouble is going to be this one. I choose, after a lot of research, I choose to fix this one for a number of reasons. So these are, you know, the few kind of angles from which you can generate a graphic representation. So the problem is you can represent the path of the writer in the field of possibilities. You can represent the path of the character, all the characters, which makes it even more complex when you have a diagram representing like five characters, each of them following its own emotions and impulsions and desires, etc. And but all this is, of course, involves time. So how do you, which is one of the big issues, how do you represent, you know, time dynamics within something that goes from, you know, a small step, adds small steps, you know?
Maybe what can also be a little bit liberating sometimes is to build a graphic representation of the audience experience of the film that you think you're building, meaning that you can, you play with the level of information that you give to the audience, and you say, oh, in this part, I want to build a mystery. I want to be very, to build tension with mystery. So the level of information is very low. And then I want to build empathy with the characters, so I have to raise a little bit the level of information. But then I will make it drop again, and then I will make it higher. And then you play with this idea that you're talking to someone, and you have different kind of graphic representation. And I think this,
that's
the
really
fact that,
interesting,
that
actually,
you can have different kind of tools is very playful and exciting, more than one representation.
And that also is, it taps into something I think that you sometimes feel as a screenwriter or filmmaker, which is what we're saying, that again, it's a vision, that sometimes you know the shape of something, or that you know what you want them to feel in some moment, but you don't necessarily know that linear. So actually changing the perspective, even in terms of like this mind map, is actually really interesting. I'd never thought of it like doing something through the audience.
There's also a very natural kind of mind map which we create when we, something which is very useful when you're working with, when you're co-writing, when at least two people are in the same room trying to co-elaborate a path. It's the use of post-its, right? So you use post-its as, I don't have post-its here, but let's say you put here small post-its, one after another, each being representing a segment of action, and you put keywords on it that you define together. So it means that here you have anger, and here you have keywords. Or anger or road, you know, the place where you are, etc. And so
just one question about who decided to put anger and road.
It's a collaboration between the two co-writers.
So again, this could be randomly decided.
Yes.
You could have a big box with words.
Yes.
And pick them by random.
Yes. But it's also linked to, you know, the name of the character. It's the keywords that help you identify what is that segment of action or interaction between the humans you're talking about. And the thing is, at the end of the day, you have a board full of these small post-its. You better choose post-its that stick on the board, right? So use real ones. And what is interesting is that without saying it, it creates, because you do it with your own hands, which is not a computer, and because it's full of the tracks of your changes, the tracks of, oh no, let's take out this word, let's put another one, etc. You ingest a common shape on which you can put colors linked to the different type of intensity, you know, love scenes get a one color, etc. So it creates some kind of a, I wouldn't call that a diagram, but I would call that, with you know, after a few days of work, a common representation that creates a visual impact on you of a shape, of a rhythm, which is very different and very complementary very different from the script itself, you know, very, very different. And you can decide in terms of rhythm with that, you know, you can say, okay, this creates a proper movement, and you see when what appears, and with that it creates a common sensation of balance to which you can relate together, and you come back to it little by little. Of course it changes all the time. This is why you put post-its, because the post-its, you can take one out, put it into the garbage and replace it by a new one, and you can take this one and put it at the end, and you can replace it all the time. But my question is, isn't there, from that pragmatic approach with post-its, isn't there the possibility to evolve towards a more clever tool of representation?
Well, you know, something I do with the post-its, but I don't know if it's more clever, is that I put them on the floor, and I imagine that it's, my floor is the sky, and that the post-its are all my stars. And then some ones I cut like a bigger size because like, and I give them like, sometimes they have a theme or they're a plot point or something. And I put everything out, so it's like exactly, it's like my map of stars. And then when, as I start to kind of, and they all have different, I have different colors also for different things. So like, so I can recognize certain story trajectories that I have, you know, like one might be, you know, like the love interest between the two. And then I kind of, in the end, I align them so that I create my constellation of stars, you know, and I can also see like from like, say, some that are bigger, you know, where those are like bigger points for me, plot points. And so in the end, I end up having kind of like, yeah, like an astrological sign.
Yeah.
May I give you an example of drawings of a quite famous script so we can maybe know everyone? It's the Antichrist of Lars von Trier. So the line of the script, as the first animal that it encounters, which is the fox, if I remember well, is at 0 minutes of the script, which I don't remember exactly when. The second one, it begins there and is at another point, which is reduced from the first one in terms of time. And this, I think, the raven, I don't remember exactly now the sequences. And the third one is reduced as well. And the three one together is also reduced time. In fact, he is until the end. He's creating a triangle. But the triangle is also the frame that the psychological, the guy, which is a psycholog, try to draw in terms of investigate about the trauma and the problem that his wife has. And the problem of the pyramid, in terms of dialogue with what she's creating, is also a triangle, but is an inverted one. And the problematic of the film itself is an inverted concern of the sexuality, meaning that the woman, she keeps the is male, is husband in the service of her pathology, and the male, in order to liberate himself, has to reverse this kind of sexuality of his woman. So it's a kind of a triangle which represented the two sexes, and it's also the framework and the drawing of the script itself. It reveals to you what you are dealing with.
I should have said that at the beginning, but this is exactly a diagram, because diagrams are exactly to break time linear representation.
Exactly. It's
the role of them, to break that kind of linear representation.
As a writer, Natalie, you feel that can you see the shape of your story when you're diving into the draft itself?
But I think I never jump into the draft, like when you were saying this page 100 thing, I thought, thank God, I don't think I've ever got to page 100 and not known, because I do a lot of pre-work of treatments or this. But I mean, I think it's really interesting, because of course you wonder like to what extent you would go as a writer. Like, I can't imagine going so far as a writer to like think in terms of like such complex diagrams before I start writing. But then actually I was thinking, but in fact I do the colors and the blocks and map out all my kind of, and when I'm stuck often I go back to these colored blocks to sort of figure out, especially what's missing, I think in that sense. But it is usually at a more outline stage where I'm like, I feel something is wrong here. And if I look at everything that I have, you know, with these colors, like, is there a predominance of red, you know, or is there a predominance of green? And if those colors are themes, you know, it helps me a lot to see if there's an imbalance in the kind of characters or twists or story. So it is. It's very interesting.
But it's really interesting what you are saying, because it's again the vision the global vision and the awareness of the situation. So you go back to something very simple in structure that guide you within something complex with a lot of interaction. And if there is something, I'm just speaking my mind. When you write on a computer screen, you have, for example, set of 10 characters in your script. They are represented by nodes and interactions. Whenever they interact or something, there is a link between them. And after a session of work or after a few days, you have sort of representation of the network of interactions. Mm-hmm. So it's figure, you can see nodes, interactions, you can see when there is a balance, when there is not. You can have this, but it's something that is done automatically, you know. It's from your writing. If you are writing character one, character two, they talk together or they look at each other. So it's something that can help to have both visions from the character and from the scriptwriter. So instead of having two tools, you have them mapped. And it helps, you know, to have this just in one representation, the meshes, you know, the network of connection or interaction between the characters.
Yeah, I mean, recently on the last film, I had many, many notes from, you know, the different execs, development execs on the script and stuff, but it was already like quite, it was actually at script stage, it was more to actually address their things rather than things that I necessarily wanted to do. And I did feel a bit just stuck into trying to decipher what they were asking of me, you know, like, because often you don't get very clear things, you know, it's kind of like, and actually in that case, doing this, like really this color, just each color for each sort of thread of the, because obviously there's multiple characters and different stories within it, and just putting them out, like I can still, it's the one thing I can still think on the page of how those, the reds and the blues and the greens.
Memorize.
And I have it in my mind, like, and of course then it took some time and it was a very reductive exercise in some way that you have to take with a pinch of salt, but it did kind of help me sort of, let's say, organize the stream of thoughts, you know, that someone is telling you, but maybe this character is a bit, you know, I don't feel empathy with him, you know, so you're like, well, okay, if this character is doing this and this and this, and these are his colors, but here actually in this section, there's no blue at all. You know, maybe this is a section where I can reintroduce him, or the love story is lost. I don't feel the love story, you know? So then you have look at your love story and you see in red, obviously, like, where...
And for example, changing the colors?
I use different colors.
You said obviously in red.
Yeah, no, maybe I will try, you're right. Maybe it will give me a different insight onto what the love story should be like, in fact. But maybe if it was a sick love story, I would have done it a different color, you know. But it's a very beautiful love story, so.